So I have been using the Poco F4 GT as my daily smartphone for about 2 weeks. And the question that I keep getting from you in my hands-on and the first impressions video was number one, is this better than the Poco F3? Number two, if you already have the Poco F3, is this worth upgrading? And will there even be a regular non-GT version of the Poco F4 without the whole gaming triggers and all? Well, let me give you those answers in this video. Now here's a recap of the specs of the phone, so feel free to pause this video to see the exact variant that I have. Now, as usual, during my full video reviews, I don't go into the technicality of the phone, where instead it will be based on using the phone daily from the build quality and the design perspective. Firstly, yes, I love the smartphone's rear finish, and while it is not minimal like the Poco F3, but I love how it stood out from an aesthetic point of view because the stealth black version did look like a typical gaming smartphone, and that cyber yellow color was strikingly yellow that someone might even notice the phone from a mile away. So in my humble opinion, this night silver color had a great balance between having a very unique look and of course being different than a typical smartphone. Now based on my daily usage, the phone had the right weight and it felt nice in the hands, and I even confidently used the phone without any case because I did have that sort of confidence that the phone will never slip off of my hands due to the finish at the back of the phone. Now speaking of the back, there is a notification LED at the camera bump area when you get a message, or even during game turbo mode, or it also acts as a battery charging status. But to be honest, since I usually put my face up like this, it didn't impact my daily usage at all. Then the whole magnetic pop-up triggers did come in handy for me as I remapped one to turn the phone into vibrate mode with a double press, and pressing and holding goes to the silent mode when I record my YouTube videos like right now or doing my live hosting sessions on Shopee. Then the second button on the right was used to record a video for my Instagram stories quickly when I double clicked on it, and pressing and holding it records an audio for me to make some quick voice notes, especially when I'm reviewing this phone where I just left all the buttons to pop up all the way. Now I have to be honest to say that I initially thought that these trigger buttons would be something that I wouldn't use it daily, but I am happy to note that I did find it very useful indeed. So overall, I would say that I was really impressed on how the build quality was and the overall out of the ordinary smartphone design when I was using the phone every single day. Now the F-series smartphones from Poco had all these great displays on your phones, and while it's not a huge of a difference compared to the Poco F3, I love how the refresh rate is now adaptive, hence it will adjust the screen refresh rate based on how you use the phone. Now this means, in layman terms in case you did not know, that if you're using the phone to read something, it will save the battery by lowering the overall refresh rate, and if you're scrolling into very fast content or even multitasking, then it will increase the refresh rate accordingly. Now there is an option to select to force it to go to 120Hz or even 60Hz all the way, but I went with the dynamic refresh rate mode all the way since it had the best of both worlds of being snappy when it needs to and of course saving battery at the same time. Now I also love how the screen's brightness adapts very well to any type of environment that you're in, so the PWM dimming technology in the phone does work flawlessly and making the phone very visible and pleasing whether or not you are in a brightly lit area or even a harsh daylight or even a very dim area as well. Now because the screen had a widevine L1 on Netflix with HDR support, watching videos on Netflix, YouTube and even on Disney Plus Hotstar during my cardio sessions in the gym was really lovely when consuming video content every single day on this 6.6 inch FHD Plus AMOLED display thanks to its high accurate color screen. Now a quick camera recap in case you have missed my previous video on the phone, as the Poco F4 GT comes with a 64 megapixel f1.9 IMX686 sensor for the main camera, an 8 megapixel f2.2 ultra-wide lens, and a 2 megapixel f2.4 macro lens. Then the front camera has a 20 megapixel f2.2 lens. Now, starting from the high 64 megapixel mode, the image quality was really good with ultra sharp details, so you can crop accordingly as usual during this high resolution mode. But because of its file size, be sure to use this mode sparingly. Then switching into the ultra wide lenses, I love how the colors and the image quality were consistent throughout with just the right focal length with absolutely no barrel distortions at the sides. Then switching over to the main lenses, the image quality was amazing over here with no color shifts coming from the ultra wide lenses. Switching to this main lens or even to the 2x zoom mode, where not only it kept the images very sharp, but it also looked very consistent as though it had a dedicated telephoto lens in this 2x zoom. So it was really nice to know, but of course the 10x zoom images will be an overall softer image when you're in that mode. Then the portrait mode for humans was also excellent with fantastic subject to background blur. However, the skin tone seems like there was a little beauty mode over here, or probably my buddy Mo was extra pretty in these shots. And also it works flawlessly when it comes to taking portrait mode on subjects as well. Now the macro mode on the camera was probably one of the things that I felt could improve on, because focusing wasn't as easy and you do get some decent results when you get the right focus and of course the right distance of the macro mode shots. Then the ultra wide night mode shots kept everything very nicely balanced, where the skies didn't look like it was forced into a different color to brighten the skies up, where the highlights were nice and the shadows were not noisy at all. Then the image quality for the main lenses on the night mode was a tad bit brighter, but again maintained an excellent quality even at 2x zoom. But if you decide to go up to 10x zoom, please don't, because the images will look like this. Now while there is a night mode when you switch to the selfie camera, but I kind of prefer how the images look in the non-night mode during some decent night lights. But if there's very little light, you will have some amount of noise and smudges in the image. And the performance of the portrait mode during at night was really great over here, as long as there is some light around you when you're taking a shot. However, both the regular selfies and the portrait selfies during the day were simply amazing with fantastic dynamic range, and the subject to background separation was also really flawless too. Then the video recording quality for the main lenses during the day was equally as good as the images, where it records up to 4K 60 frames per second. Video stabilization for the main lens was really great even when moving through a fast pace. Then the video stabilization for the ultra-wide lenses was also great, but keep in mind that it only goes up to 1080p 30 frames per second. Now, although the front camera can only record up to 1080p 60 frames per second, but when it comes to the image stabilization, it was pretty good, especially when it comes to the dynamic range as well. Now switching over to the nighttime video recording, the main lenses did perform well in terms of the quality of the footage. However, the stabilization isn't the greatest over here, and since the ultra-wide lenses record at a lower resolution, so expect a degrade of footage when it comes to recording the ultra-wide lenses during at night. Now speaking of degrading footage, the front video isn't the best trait, as you will need a lot of light, otherwise you'll end up with some noisy footage and jittering stabilization. Now the good news is that compared to the recent Poco X4 Pro that I've just reviewed, the phone had some overheating issues while taking photos and videos, where it dimmed the screen to the point where I couldn't even see the screen, and that was not the case when it comes to the Poco F4 GT, so that was really great to know. And of course, here is a quick video and audio recording test to see how well the audio recording is when it comes to using the microphones on the phone.
Ha! Yo! So this is an audio video test using the front camera. It's about 6:15 p.m. So this is how it looks from a lighting condition. I am still very annoyed at how it records only at 1080p up until today. But it's nice to know that, you know, the audio and the video recording is still very good and is very usable for any social media situations. So let me know what you guys think in the comment section below.
So do let me know what you think of the camera's performance overall, and if you're enjoying this video, a thumbs up would be very nice, and of course a subscription would be awesome as well. Now as for the phone software, it is shipped with MIUI version 13.0.2 with the Poco skin on top of Android 12. And as of the recording of this video, it was at the same exact version as well. And yes, I am so glad that it wasn't on Android 11 instead, like some of their recently released smartphones. And during my first impressions and up till now, using the phone for about 2 weeks, even though the Android skin is not my personal favorite in my humble opinion, it is nice to know that the software is really stable right now with no issues, with super fast response when scrolling and navigating through the phone, and even when opening many apps at the same time, loading websites, and the haptics on the phone was something that I really liked when I was using the phone daily. Now, while we all know that how notorious the Snapdragon 8 Gen 1 chipset is when it comes to overheating, I am extremely pleased to report that because of the liquid cool technology on the phone, it handled the heat very well. But that's not to say that it did not get hot at all, because the only time it became warm was during a very heavy gaming, which is the obvious topic that we are going to be talking about next. Now, I'm going to go out of my way by saying this right now. If you love gaming, this phone is a huge must. Now, firstly, whether or not you're a casual gamer or a hardcore gamer, I can honestly say that the magnetic trigger buttons were really convenient when it comes to having it during gaming, whether or not it's on casual gaming on games like Asphalt 9 to FPS games like PUBG Mobile or even Genshin Impact. And speaking of PUBG Mobile, it was at Ultra HD for the graphics and frame rate was set at Ultra, and the gameplay was extremely smooth with beautiful and very sharp graphics. There was no battery drain even after playing the game for about 30 minutes straight, and the game trigger came in super handy and it felt very easy to use and also easy to click compared to some other gaming smartphones like the Black Shark series that I've just recently tried. And the idea of having a combination of jumping and shooting accurately is something that is not easily achieved without this gaming trigger due to its placement of the pop-up buttons, and the high refresh rate also helped when it comes to the overall responsiveness when it comes to gaming as well. Then going into the gameplay of Genshin Impact, I honestly had super low expectations because I still feel that if you want to get the best Genshin Impact experience, just get an iPhone or an iPad because of Apple's Bionic chipset. But I was extremely amazed during gameplay over here. And it performed very well at medium settings at 60 frames per second with motion blur turned on, not off, like how it had with every other Android smartphones, including the S22 Ultra. I just couldn't believe my eyes because the animation was extremely smooth, especially when it comes to the motion blur. Graphics were amazing and the gameplay had no stutter or lag issues, while it did get warm for about 45 minutes, but it was not too hot to the touch. And the overall heat dispersed throughout the whole entire back area of the phone compared to some other Android smartphones, which tend to overheat towards the top of the camera bump area, similar like how the Snapdragon 8 Gen 1 smartphones are. Then the battery also went down about 3% during my first 30 minutes of gameplay, and for the rest of the gaming sessions, it went down significantly slow, which of course is a huge plus. And yes, I did find that the overall audio experience for the phone to be really nice due to its symmetrical quad speakers, and the phone also had Dolby Atmos and high-res audio support, making this phone the best Android smartphone that I've ever gamed Genshin Impact on. Now, as for the phone's battery, it has 4,700 mAh of battery, and the battery drain was also at a very great range, where I was about 35% with close to 4.5 hours of screen on time when I was using it to take lots of videos and photos on the phone. Now, it do last the whole day and sometimes before noon the next day, depending on how heavy of gaming that you use the phone with. And the 120 watts hypercharge did come in clutch, since I never usually charge my phone overnight, where I would usually just charge it when I wake up and go about my usual morning routine and it's all full for me to use, which is similar to the claimed charging speeds of 0 to 100% in about 17 minutes. And while Poco claimed that you can also charge the phone while gaming to get up to 27 minutes on a full charge, I did not do that since firstly having the cable coming out at the sides was something that I did not really enjoy. And secondly, I did not come to a point whereby I was playing games on the phone where I had to charge the phone as well. So in conclusion, coming at a price of 2,299 ringgit, the Poco F4 GT is a very compelling option of having a hybrid flagship and a gaming smartphone. And during the period that I used the phone, I had absolutely no issues when it comes to using this phone daily. Now, whether or not there will be a regular Poco F4 without the GT and of course the whole gaming aspect behind it. Now, there have been rumors that we might see a Poco F4, but knowing Poco as a brand, we might or might not even get it because there still isn't any official word if they're planning to bring that globally. And yes, I'm very familiar of the K series being like a global version of the F series. But like I've always said in my channel, if there's no official news, that also means no news for me. So in this in-depth review, we finally have an answer to all of the questions mentioned in the beginning of this video. So is this better than the Poco F3? Yes, it is, because of its superior gaming performance, and the trigger buttons is something that you think that you might not need until you have them. Now the battery performance is slightly better because of its adaptive refresh rate, and the charging speeds are hell of an upgrade, making it a slightly better phone than the Poco F3. Then on to the question that if you already have the Poco F3, should you upgrade to the Poco F4 GT? Well, if you really game a lot, then yes. If not, I would say no, because if you're not a hardcore gamer, then you won't find the trigger buttons to be very useful, even though you can use it to remap on other actions. Then the screen quality is about the same, although the refresh rate on the Poco F4 is adaptive, and the 120 watts charging is a super nice thing to have, but not really necessary to have, because look at the charging speeds of the iPhone, man. And still, I use it daily without any issues. And finally, thanks to the software updates, the Poco F3 still has a very similar camera performance that the Poco F4 GT has. And speaking of the Poco F3, comparing it with this particular phone, if you like for me to do a comparison video, give me a hell yeah in the comment section below.
Give me a hell yeah!
And I'll do one for y'all as soon as I can.